Once you turn it from play into a job, it kind of loses some of its sparkle. Now, I realize that there are people out in the world who have more conservative views about work and work ethic, and they just believe that too bad if you don't like it, and too bad if you don't have fun. A job's a job. Nobody said it was supposed to make you happy. It's just what you do, and you just knuckle down and pull yourself up by your bootstraps and just get her done. You know, I understand there are a lot of people who are raised with that and believe in that, and I think there's merit to that. I'm not judging anybody else for believing something different. I'm just telling you who I am. And as a creative person, it might be different for me because my mind probably doesn't work the same as a lot of other people's minds. But when I was growing up, nobody ever said, you can be whatever you want to be. I think because of the way I grew up, which was interesting, and I can go into that more later. I think that my family of origin just hoped that my siblings and I would be normal people, law-abiding, and that we'd be able to take care of ourselves, feed ourselves, and that we would live to be adults to do that. And the schools that I went to, my career counselor never sat down with me and said, so, do you want to be a brain surgeon? Do you want to be a teacher? Do you want to build rockets? What do you want to do? He basically sat down with me, and I remember this, his name was Mr. Morales, and it was in high school, and I was, I think, a sophomore, and he was doing an assessment. Back then they used to do that, because most of the kids in the schools that I went to were high-risk kids. They came from homes that struggled, neighborhoods that struggled, and at that time I think that they were just trying to identify kids who needed services, who needed a little extra paying attention to. And I was a bright kid. I, you know, showed up well in class and I participated. I struggled with math. That's about it. I didn't struggle with science. I think math was my only struggle. But as a kid who tested well and who did well and who was put in classes with other kids who did well, I would have expected that he would have said, you know, let's talk about what you might want to do with the rest of your life. What are you interested in? You know, career counselor paid attention more to, I think, my family history and the neighborhood I was raised in, and decided, if I can keep this kid from going to jail or getting pregnant before high school's out, then I've done my job. And so that's the talk he had with me. I know he was doing his best. I watched my parents struggle in their life with addiction. I knew that was something I didn't want. No. To be quite honest, I don't think I was ever headed down that road as a person. But he just added like this extra layer of fear. I think I'd have been better served if he would have directed me and helped me, I don't know, have some goals as far as my education and after high school. But he did, it wasn't wasted on me. Instead of saying, my goal is to get into a really good school and to figure out how to get a nice scholarship, my goal was just to stay out of jail and to not get pregnant. And I never did. I never did go to jail, and I made it through high school without getting pregnant. He said, kids who come from backgrounds like you, this is the percentage of the kids who die. This is the percentage of the kids who end up in jail. These are the percentage of kids who end up with addictions. These are the percentage of kids that just disappear off the face of the planet. And here is a percentage of kids that actually have some kind of normal life. It's like, it was like 3% or something like that. And the only way for you to be a part of this tiny bitty 3% is to graduate from high school. And I believed him. So even when it wasn't possible for me to go to regular high school because of my situation in life and my need to work, and my sister and I both went to night school, so did my brother, and we all graduated in different ways because, honestly, you know, we didn't have childhoods. We didn't have the freedom to just waste the whole day sitting in a classroom. That was a luxury for us. So we worked, and then we went to school half day, we worked, and then we went to school at night, all of us. We didn't have cap and gown graduations. We didn't have that normal kind of thing. So I do know how to work hard. I know how to knuckle down. But the one thing that I always knew without anybody telling me is that when I did something I loved, I did it well, and it didn't feel like work. I think the feedback I got was, you just work and work and work until you die, you know? Whatever job you can get, save your money, work hard. Save your money, work hard. Yeah, so nobody said, hey, you know, you should take a look inside of yourself and find out what you love and follow your dreams. That wasn't the feedback I got when I was young. My husband had a full-time job and he was going to college. Well, I did go to nursing school, not because I so much wanted to be a nurse. I was always interested in the medical field, and as a kid, I wanted to be a doctor. I wanted to be a surgeon specifically, but I also wanted to be a rock star, and I also wanted to be an astronaut, so can't take that too seriously. I just thought it would be a good thing. I wanted to help people, and I specifically loved labor and delivery and emergency medicine. So I thought I would do something like that. Sometimes you make a plan and the universe gives you a U-turn. I'm trying to learn to trust that. Still, sometimes I just get mad. So little by little, I went to nursing school. I ended up dropping out because it was just too much of a demand on my family, most especially my husband, who just had a really hard time with it. And then when I dropped out, the hospital I was working at offered a in-house program to me for training, and I took it. They trained me to be a surgical technician, and because I was already working in the hospital, happened to have an opening up on labor and delivery, and what they needed was kind of an on-call scrub nurse. You were there, you did a bunch of, I did a bunch of things on that floor, you know, I checked in patients, I did monitoring, I got rooms ready for patients, I did intake, I made files, I stocked the ORs, I got Chryslemans ready. Those are those big heating units that go in for deliveries. I sat with patients who didn't have a birthing partner, or maybe came from a county jail, and that kind of thing. When we had C-sections, whether they were scheduled or emergencies, usually emergencies, I was available to get the OR ready to go. And sometimes it would be back to back, and it was super fun, sometimes heartbreaking, but I loved the energy and I loved working in surgery. And it was like one of the best things that ever happened to me. My husband would change jobs, get transfers, and I just kind of followed. And when there was a little space open for me, I decided to go to art school. It felt super, super selfish, but it felt right, and I can't explain it. There was something inside of me that said, this is the direction you need to go. And I was helped along by a book that I picked up randomly called The Artist's Way. And I did the whole book. It's like a 12-step program for closet artists. And I did the whole book, and by the time I was done, I knew that this was who I was. And I ended up going to art school. The first year, I got a little bit of money to go, but I would have to pay back the loans for the rest of the money, and I didn't know how I was gonna do it. I mean, we had two kids at the time, and this was before my daughter was diagnosed, and you know, we had bills that we were just barely making and stuff, but I just knew, don't worry about it, leap, the net will appear. And I ended up getting a National Endowment of the Arts grant for merit. I didn't think I was gonna get it, I got it. It offset most of my tuition. I had to commute every day, sometimes twice a day. It was far away. It was hard on my kids, it was hard on me. But the first day I showed up at art school, I felt like I was home. I felt like these are my people, I belong here. I'd never felt that way before. Everything else felt like I was playing a part in a play and I was doing what I was supposed to be doing. This felt like home. And then I got pregnant with my son and my daughter ended up getting sick. It all like played out perfectly, but at the time it didn't seem like it was. At the time it just seemed like chaos and bad luck and the worst possible thing. It's like the universe said, bad stuff's coming, but we're gonna make sure that you're okay. And so I got these years in art school where my soul was fed. I showed up equipped with the medical knowledge that I needed. I had this great little boy. He was a light in our lives. She passed away. He was the thing that I could hold on to. I know, I don't mean to be a bummer. You know, there's the difference between doing a job because you must, and sometimes you just have to, and having a passion for something. Now, I know this is a weird way to come full circle, but because I knew what I was passionate about and because I explored that, my son happens to be a super creative kid, and because I understood how important it is to work from a place of passion, I was able to support him. It worked out for him. You know, he's 20 years old, he writes, he produces, he's successful at what he does, and he loves doing what he does. And this isn't about him as much, but here is a kid who, at one point in his early part of his career, was given opportunities, and he said, no, thank you. And I said, oh my goodness, if you do this, I know it's not what you love the most, but if you do this, you'll have enough money to do other things later. And he said, that would be going against who I am. I'm an artist, and I want to make the art that's inside of me. And if I'm never rich, and I never drive a great car, and I never live like, you know, Kanye West, I'm okay with that. Because if I get to get up every day and do the thing that I love, and I get to take the art inside of me and bring it out here, then I'm already rich, Mom. And as a parent, you want to say, oh, hell no, buddy, because you need to pay a mortgage, and you might have kids that need to be fed, and you're going to need shoes, and you know, being a starving artist, that sounds romantic, but in real life, it is not romantic to live in your car. I wanted to say that. But as an artist, I understood it. Living a life with challenges and having certain experiences kind of shape who you are. So it doesn't matter how much money you have. It doesn't matter what the house looks like that you live in. Nobody likes to struggle. But I think that some of the struggles the universe throws at us helps us to realize who we are. Sorry, I just got way off topic. I'm waiting for these babies to flash so that I can put them in the oven and so we can keep playing, and I may delete most of this anyway. That's my sermon for the day. I'm gonna get these babies cooking, and then I'm gonna pull out the babies that I just assembled, and we will get them dressed, and hopefully I can make that some kind of fun. We'll be back in a little bit.